on the application of Cello Partnerships, DBA Verizon Wireless, for a special permit or variance to replace existing non-conforming structure deficient lattice-style communication tower with a new modern lattice-style tower and transfer all the antennas from one and remove the old tower off the site. Supporting materials and statements of the supported incorporated into the made part of the application. The tower is located on the 1 Pine Nook Road, Lot 80, Lot 1. So this is a tower that's been in town for some time, and these folks have been in front of us before for alterations and so forth. So if you would just give us a scope of what you want to do, and we'll go from there.
Okay, thank you. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Carl Gehring, and I'm joined by experts who are with me. If you could raise your hand. So Elizabeth Jamison, representing Verizon Wireless's real estate department. Next to her is Jay Latore, the RF or radio frequency engineer. Back here, you have Jason Mead, structural engineer, Dolly or Dorothy Rona, Eversource, and Bradley Parsons, civil engineer, and then Dave Ford representing AT&T. We also have Mr. Camosa representing the town of Deerfield. And the reason I introduce the town of Deerfield is that they are the underlying landowner. Eversource is our landlord, so that actually Ms. Rona has two hats on, one representing Eversource as Verizon's landlord, and also lessee from the town, and also a hat of a telecommunications engineer on behalf of Eversource. So this site, as you point out, has been there for years, been there for almost 30 years, existing tower, and we simply want to replace it with a like-for-like exact replacement and take the other one down. And what I want to do very quickly, I know you put me first, which I appreciate, so I'm going to run through very fast the contents of the 10 tabs that I provided, and in doing so, may answer some of your questions in advance. The second page of my cover sheet is a table of contents of those 10 tabs. Under the first of the town forms, we're asking for a special permit to replace a non-conforming structure, like for like, and also to the extent necessary a variance. And I'm going to say we do need that because, Mr. Chairman, I'll defer to your judgment on the last situation where we had a very similar one. Is it variance only because we're increasing a non-conforming a very minor amount? And I'll show that on the plan. So we're asking for those two forms of relief. And the second tab is the narrative where I've outlined that and gone through all the various points of the special permit, the wireless communications section, non-conforming section, and made a section, a 48 section 10 argument about the variance, because I know you're very strict on the requirements for those, but we feel we qualify. And then number three are two letters of authorization, one from the town as the landowner, and another one from Eversource as our landlord. Eversource actually owns this tower, and we, Verizon, as part of our deal with them, have agreed to take the lead to rebuild it, do all this planning and zoning and so forth, and then turn it over to them when we're done, just like we did with the South York Fire Station, the fire station site, where we took the lead to construct and so forth, and that's going to be turned over to the fire station, fire district. We're turning this back over to Eversource. They own the tower now. They're going to continue to own it. We're just doing this development portion. Under the third tab, or the fourth tab, a field card and tax map. You're already familiar with the site. And then I put under the fifth tab affidavits from these various engineers, Mr. Latore representing Verizon Wireless, Ms. Rona representing Eversource, and from Mr. Ford's group at AT&T. These are very critical sites. As you all know, with your smartphones and the wireless communications and controlling the grid, we absolutely have to keep this on air. We're not proposing to change anything other than put it on a new structure. But these affidavits attest to the critical importance of this in all of our networks. And that's another reason why I brought all these folks out tonight. This isn't a complicated application. It's really simple, but it's very important to all of these entities that this gets done, which is why we brought all the experts out. Now, under the next two tabs are two engineering letters. One is, rather than give you a stack of papers this thick on how we arrived at the conclusion, the professional engineers have determined that this tower is structurally deficient. What's happened is the building code has changed over the years. So it was built 30 years ago. It was fine. It was under this so-called revision E of the building code under 780 CMR. Then they went to revision F, and then they recently went to revision G. And what had happened, every time they updated that code, it got more strict on what we could and couldn't do. And so with the new revision, it's one of these situations where it's like if you buy a commercial building that's non-conforming, it's not up to code, but you're operating it fine. You can go in there and continue business. But as soon as you want to change something or put an addition on or do anything, now you all of a sudden you got to bring the whole thing up to code. It's similar kind of analogy. The tower doesn't meet the code. And over the years, as those revisions to the code were made, they went and put reinforcements on structurally in an extra cross brace or whatever. But it's beyond that now. It's the point where these engineers looked at it. We've been studying it. Obviously, if we could avoid the expense of having to rebuild it, we would do that. It's beyond that now, where the safest and easiest and most prudent course of action is just to simply build a new one and take that one down. And that letter from the engineer attests to that. The second one is the sway tolerance. In addition to the Verizon AT&T antennas up there, we have very critical communications that links for Eversource that are straight line of sight microwave dishes that have to point right on to meet their antenna on the other end, and the monopole will not satisfy that sway tolerance. So this is a lattice. We're proposing to replace it with a lattice to just go like for like so that it can maintain that sway tolerance. And that's the engineering letter that attests to that. Under number number eight, is a letter from a real estate appraiser. One of the conditions or one of the things you must consider when you're deciding whether to approve a nonconforming, the continuation of a nonconforming use, is will it have more detrimental impact to the neighborhood than the existing? Will it have any additional deleterious impact or not? Or will it be substantially more detrimental? And this is always critical when you're thinking, okay, real estate values and so forth. Well, this is not a new tower. This is not a new site. It's existing. It's been there for 30 years. We're not proposing to change that. We had an appraiser nonetheless analyze that, who came to the conclusion that no, because it's already there, any impact would have occurred 30 years ago. It's going to be, in his opinion, not more detrimental. And in our opinion, it would be more detrimental not to do something with this because it's got a structure problem. Our hands are tied. No one can do anything with it. It needs to be replaced to make it safe and for future generations to continue on up there. Under the next tab are some photo simulations. Now, these are not like the typical photo simulations you see when you're proposing a new site up close. We took these from town roads down where you'd actually see it from members of the public. As you know, the site's very high up in the hill. We have before and after in there. You can see it's a very de minimis, almost impossible to see difference, where in our opinion, members of the public will not notice anything change. Then the last tab, you have plans in front of you. The first sheet, Z1.0, is the overall site plan. If you're familiar with the property, if you ever walked up to the rock, there are three towers up there, actually. There's one like right on the edge of the cliff, practically. That's not ours. There's another one that's inland and a little bit lower in the woods. That's not ours either. That's an old radio station or whatever. Ours is the one that looks like the one that's on the edge of the cliff, but it's set back away from the cliff. It's the lattice tower. And then on the next sheet, we show these setbacks. Now, this is where we're asking for a special permit to replace an existing nonconforming structure, like for like. However, it's actually going to be a little bit smaller footprint and a little bit lower in height. The existing one is a little over 120 feet tall, and we noticed in the bylaw 120 feet is technically the limit for a tower. So we thought, well, you know what? Even though it's existing, it's like for life. We're going to build a new one anyway. Why don't we at least render that portion of it conforming? So we lowered it by a few feet. So now it's 120 max, so it's conforming to height now. And the footprint will be almost the same, but if anything, a little bit tighter. And you say, well, how's that possible if you're making it structurally more sturdy and more rugged and all that? The difference is in unseen things to the naked eye. It would take an engineer or someone with the technical knowledge to really get into it. But the existing one, for example, the vertical legs are hollow pipes. The new one is going to be solid steel. The cross members are going to be hardened steel. It's just overall a beefier structure. But the appearance, I don't think anyone without technical ability would be able to notice anything changed. We are going to build it about 30 feet offset. Now, the tower we did it out at the fire station, if you recall, we were able to use what's called a cow or a temporary structure. We haven't done that site yet, but we're proposing to stay on air temporarily with this sort of temporary structure. And that one was going to be rebuilt in the exact same footprint. This, we can't do that up here. This thing is so much beefier. It's up on a hillside, and that's another reason why this whole structural code changed. They changed the way they consider towers on top of escarpments, where you have wind coming along and it accelerates over the top of the hill. That's one of the reasons why this tower needs to be beefed up now. And we can't use a temporary cow-type structure and still have end-use microwave sway. So we have to build a new one right next to it without blocking the signal of the existing one, because we want to stay on air. So we figured out a place to put it about 30 feet away. It's right next door, basically. Then we transfer everything over, and then we dismantle the other one, and it comes down and cleaned up, and no one, in our opinion, will notice the difference, as you can see from those pictures. But here's where the variance comes into play. Whereas the one at the fire station, Now, both of these were asked for a special permit. The variance of the fire station was because we, in effect, increased the fall zone nonconformity by going up in height. Even though we were in the exact same footprint, we went taller and therefore got closer relatively to the lot line, and that increased the nonconformity, so we asked for a variance. That one, we didn't move the distance, so its distance to residence has stayed the same. This one up here, we have no problem meeting the fall zone, but the distance to residence, 500 feet in your section 4400, is technically towers are supposed to be 500 feet from residences, residential lot lines. Well, this doesn't conform now, and it's not going to conform. And it's basically the same thing. However, it does change very slightly in the sense that here it is now. So it's 164 from this lot line. But again, these lot lines are almost like a fiction in the sense they're up there on the hill. It's not like it's right in someone's backyard right over there. You know, it's up there. It's definitely, but that's the legal property line. 264 feet to this one, 463 feet to that one. Now, when we move it, we put it right next door, it's going to go to 138, 242, and 482. So basically, you're talking about 26-foot difference. You know, the closest, it's going to move 26 feet closer in one dimension. So in our opinion, negligible, de minimis, and therefore we respectfully ask for that variance. And then the compound, here's a blow-up of a sheet 3. Basically, we're bumping this out. Now, in order for Eversource to be able to do that, they don't own that land. The town owns that land. So they had to get the lease rights to do that. And there are laws about that under 30B that, you know, you go out for an RFP, which they bid on, which they won. And that included the expansion area of the site and construction, the ability in our lease agreement or their lease agreement, which benefits us, to have, you know, construction area around that. And then once it's done, we clean all that up, take the old tower down and get out of there. So it's a slight bump out. Now, the advantage of this, if you've been up to the site, it's already cleared and grubbed and flat. It's basically ready to go. It's a construction guy's dream. He could start tomorrow on this. There's nothing really to prepare. We're going to use the same access road. And the elevation drawing is basically, like I said, the same thing, except 120 max. We're capping it out, so it's going to be a little lower. And the footprint, I mean, this is not to scale as far as that. It's not a tower structure. But the footprint, what I've been told, is either identical or slightly smaller. Would Mr. Mead, would you concur? Yes. So that's in a nutshell. We respectfully ask for your approval. Again, this is very uncomplicated, but very important to all the entities represented here.
Okay. So we're going to ask you a couple questions.
Okay.
Then I'll ask the public if there's anybody that wants to speak in opposition, if anybody wants to speak in favor.
Okay.
We'll deliberate and we'll make a decision.
All right.
So if anybody on the board has a question, would like to ask?
I would, in regards to the road. Who takes care of the road going up to the site?
The road, we're going to have to improve the road slightly by filling in some potholes and ruts, but other than that, it's going to stay the same.
It's Western Mass Electric that takes care of it, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Western Mass takes care of the road.
Yeah, okay. And Frank, there's a gate at the bottom.
Yep, yeah.
And you know, this tower has been in front of us a few times, and this location has been in front of us a few times. The only thing we've tried to chase is to keep it locked up. I think you probably live in town calling it the Rock. You know, if somebody said the Rock, you know, people would know where you're talking. And again, to Wamiko, we've asked for that gate to be locked when you're not going up and down and doing service. And we've asked Wamiko in the past to police that. The town's not going to police it. You need to police it yourselves. So any other questions? You got any questions? All right. I have a question. I'll just try to give everybody else.
I guess I'm curious. The one at the fire station is going to be a monopole. Now, why is this still a lattice?
Because the monopole would not have a sufficient sway tolerance to satisfy Wamiko's antenna configuration. It sways too much. This is a more sturdy and rugged one. And since it's existing, it's basically a like-for-like replacement.
So I have two questions. One is, you're not changing any of the little building structures up there?
No, that's right.
And then as far as antennas, are they literally one for one, or are you changing any of the antenna configuration?
We're going to put new ones up. I mean, there are 10-year-old antennas where we're going to put new modern antennas up there.
Size-wise, less size-wise?
Again,
where's my RF guy?
It could be a little bigger again.
Okay. Similar to like what we just did with the fire station.
Exactly.
Okay. Any other questions?
But is there going to be room to add additional?
Yes, and that's a good point. Yes, there is. We're actually going to reconfigure Wamiko's spot to be able to open up a new rental spot for the town, so that if, again, that we're not involved in that, but if a carrier came along or a third party came along, they could rent through Eversource, and then that revenues, some revenue benefit would pass through to the town on that, so absolutely.
Great.
And that's another reason we can't do anything with that now. All our hands are tied. We can't add anything to it.
Okay. Any other questions? All right, if anybody in the audience would like to speak in opposition of this, anybody in the audience like to speak in favor of this? Mr. Camosa.
My name is Kip Camosa, and I'm a member of the Deerfield Select Board. And our board has discussed this quite a bit. And we've also spoke with our building inspector, and he has no problems with it. Since we couldn't determine if there was any detriment to the community, it provides a steady source of income. We'd encourage the board to approve the special permit and the variance.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is Chip Adams. I'm one of the property owners up on the top of the ridge. I just have some questions about the road. I think that was answered that it's going to be maintained by Western Mass Electric. What's the timeline for the construction?
I don't have a firm date now, but we were talking about that on a conference call recently, and it would be sometime in the summer, and the construction takes about 90 days, weather permitting.
And will there be heavy trucks going on that road, or is it all site?
No, unfortunately, it will have to be concrete trucks and a crane and all that, absolutely.
So it's crane install as opposed to like a helicopter lift?
Yes,
or something like that?
Right.
Okay. And is it just microwave and cellular?
Yeah.
Is there any broadcast?
Commercial broadcast? No. There's communications. Eversource has communications to their field crews and so forth, but no, like AM/FM broadcast, you mean?
Yeah.
No.
The reason he asked, there used to be Deerfield Academy, the school used to.
Deerfield Academy had
an antenna, a radio station
up there.
I think that might be that third tower I mentioned.
Yeah, it's still
that's,
there.
That is the third tower.
Yeah,
still there.
Right.
And then also the little shack on the edge there.
All right.
It used to have an FM antenna. I think it still has an FM antenna on that.
Okay.
Thank you very much. All right, any other questions? If not, we'll go to deliberation and we'll go to vote. Okay, so we're going to close the hearing. We're going to go to deliberation and we'll vote. So as you can hear, this has been here numerous times. This is not it's not a big change. It's the impact's not going to be there or anything like that. I don't see any major problems. Verizon has been very good with us in town. They've adhered to everything we've always asked for. So personally, I would recommend that we do this. Any other comments or things or conditions or?
No. You went through everything and get all the points. And as long as the permit says that they're going to maintain it, Western Mass going to maintain the road.
And do we need to worry about the antenna size as much as we did down here, right in town? Or?
No, the antenna size actually is coming into compliance. It used to be out of compliance.
Gotcha.
It's coming into compliance. So the what they're looking for is the variance for the non-conformance structure and a special permit.
Special permit for non-conforming, and then the variance to simply increase the non-conforming very slightly by moving it closer to one lot line but farther away from another lot line.
Okay. So anybody want to make a motion? Richard, you were.
I'm going to let Mr. Moody participate in
okay.
the vote, and that way.
All right. Ben or Linda, you want to make a motion?
Are we going to put any special permit or any special conditions, or are we just.
No,
comfortable with it.
The only one is, as we talked about, is the road.
The road.
That Wamiko.
And is that
Wamiko? What we're going to do is put the condition on it that you maintain that road, and in the critical part of maintaining that road is for public safety.
The access road from the gate up.
From the gate up, yep. From the gate up.
Would you like to ask a question?
You can throw one in, I'll just throw one in.
I'm just curious, what do you folks do up there for fire suppression, fire safety for the electronics equipment in there? How is it monitored, and do you have halon extinguishers in there to cut the fire down, or how do you folks address that?
Our switch, I can't speak on behalf of AT&T, our switch is monitored 24/7 by our switch, so they know the temperature and who's coming in and out and what's going on up there at all times. It's an unoccupied, inanimate, no human occupancy structure.
I know it's inanimate, but if it does catch fire, what happens?
I don't know if this one has a...
fire suppression inside the building when it is unoccupied.
Yes. I don't know if this particular site has FM 200 or not. I don't know. Sometimes in buildings we have that, but I think out in the woods like this, it probably doesn't. So it would be...
Just if it goes, it goes.
It goes, but it's contained in a concrete building, so it's our loss, really.
Well, but I have experience with electronic equipment and electrical equipment as it catches fire. It usually doesn't stop.
I understand about your... What you're saying is the collateral damage that might occur. Yeah. And in this case, again, I would lean towards our building commissioner and our fire department to specify what's required by law. I wouldn't put anything extra on them than's required by code. So who is going to make the motion?
So I'll make a motion that we approve.
We grant
a special permit and
a variance.
And a variance with the one condition that, is it Eversource or Wimico? We've been referring to it as. Both. Okay, Wimico doing business as Eversource is to maintain the access beyond the gate to the antenna.
You have a second? All right, so we're going to go to vote. We need a 4-1 to that this would pass. Linda, how do you vote?
In favor.
Frank?
In favor.
Right. And I also so in. In favor as well.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much. Let us just do one quick, we got to just do a couple of pieces of paper. It'll take us 2 minutes and we'll be ready to go. Rich, if you just sign, you sign, here, I'm on. You just sign, and then you say how you vote.
Thank you.
Come on, Jamie,
That's all right, I'll be the surrogate. I'll answer both.
Him to sign that, too.
Perfect.
Is that true, Bob?
He didn't vote. Yeah, he didn't. He did not.
Okay. Five people.
Great.
Vote.
Yep.
So, nice stuff.
So you got everything you need for that one?
I think so.
The only thing I'm looking for is the under the railroad one. Okay. We're going to jump to the salt shack next. I'm sorry to say salt shack instead of shed. Give me one more second and you'll set up.
Yeah.
Okay. Are you okay with the camera? You might want to come on this side.
Okay.
So if they want to get you with the camera.
from... So, Town of Deerfield's going to hold a hearing on Michael
Goth,
Salt City, Inc., for a variance of 15 feet from the maximum height, 35 feet, and to allow a construction of a 30,000-square-foot salt shed, and it'll be 50 feet in height in a commercial 2 zone. It'll be located at 100 Railroad Yard Road. All right, you can bring it closer even if you want. All right. So what I'm assuming we're talking about here is we're down by the railroad yard, or we're on the railroad yard property?
River Road, portion of the railroad yard that has frontage on River Road. So the southwestern side of the railroad yard.
And are you the owners of the property, or are you leasing the property, or what's the...
So Salt City is proposing to lease a portion of a larger parcel for this specific use from Pan Am Southern.
Okay.
Could we make the maps what's more presentable to us? Or
sure. Maybe, can you, are those the same? One's color and one's not color?
This one has a little more detail.
Okay, and you can move up. Feel free to move up. So go ahead and throw your pitch.
Yeah. So my name is Philippe Cravo from Arlovet Associates, here with Mike Goff of Salt City. Also here in the audience, we have some representatives from Pan Am Southern. We're here for the variance application for the board's consideration of a 50-foot building in the commercial 2 zone, which currently limits the height of the building to 35 feet. One of the major factors for the request of the variance is the building dimensions. Because of the way these buildings are manufactured, in order to reduce the height, you would have to elongate the building, not necessarily make it wider, and that would produce more impact on the site. And one of the main constricting factors of the site is the existing main rail line that runs, as you can see here, across the eastern side of the lease area, and also River Road on the southwestern side, and a fairly significant slope down from River Road. Another consideration we would ask the board is that due to the significant grade change in the road, there's the elevation right out front of where the building is proposed is about elevation 195. The proposed finished floor of this building is 180. There's a 15-foot grade drop from the road down to where the floor of this building is to be constructed. From that floor, it will rise up to 50 feet. As opposed to 35. So that grade change will really help to sort of minimize the visual impacts from River Road itself. The building will be set back. Currently, this whole hillside is vegetated. There are a number of wetlands run down along, associated with some existing culverts. A larger building would create additional impact within the buffer zones to those wetlands. So, you know, the two main points here are that we're really constrained on the width of due to the width of the site. The building has to be located at, you know, basically at the bottom of this hill and on the other side of the main track. And then also we're constrained on either side by the wetlands, which we're really trying to minimize the impacts. Just something else to consider is that they will be installing a new rail spur from the main line to deliver the salt to this salt shed.
So this is on the south side of the railroad tracks?
Correct.
And is that a new entrance, or is that an existing entrance?
So this is a currently developed portion of the parcel. Right, currently, maybe you can see a little better in this graphic here. So there's this long platform that runs the length of this lease area. And basically, that platform was there. It previously had a rail spur that made deliveries, and I think it was a speed delivery for Agway, I believe is what was mentioned. So basically, trucks would come in, they would unload directly off the train onto trucks and exit the site. All traffic to this property will come from, I guess, the north side of River Road back and forth. There's no anticipated truck traffic to the south of the site. The grades actually climb. They continue to climb as you go farther south on River Road.
And there's enough clearance under that bridge that's there? I don't know what the height is. There's a bridge right there on River Road.
To the north?
To the west.
Yes, sir. Most of the dump trailers that will be coming in and out will be under 10.6. I believe that bridge height is 12.3 or somewhere in that neighborhood. We are talking, you know, small dump trailers capable of carrying about 35 tons of salt.
And is it seasonal?
The outflow will be seasonal. The inflow coming in by rail will be generally throughout the whole spring, summer. We typically fill up through the first half, you know, spring, summer, early fall, and then send it out to the towns and the states as required in the winter months.
And operational hours are expected to be?
Our operational hours for unloading would be between 7 and 3. For shipping out salt, we are dictated by the hours that the towns are open to receive. Most towns are open from 7 to 3, so we would generally start shipping, if possible, as early as 6 a.m. and usually shut down around 2 or 2:30.
Is it a cone-shaped building? Do you have a side view or anything there, or just a plot view? Yeah, I do.
There is some graphics provided, some generic graphics provided by the building manufacturer itself. But I did print out a couple of sort of a section of the building that I can distribute if you guys would like to see that.
Okay.
Just like a section of the building.
Just pass one around so the board members.
Thanks.
Thank you. I believe you had a question on the driveway. That is an existing. The entrance that we're proposing is already a currently graveled entrance into that lot.
You're not changing the width of the opening or anything?
I don't believe so. I'd have to exactly measure it out, but it won't be.
So there's currently two gravel access drives. One is obviously goes down the slope right here at this location. So that one would be a little too steep for trucks. So we'll maintain the one that's farther north on River Road. And we might have to, I believe, we're just expanding the radius a little bit on the north side just so trucks can be able to get in.
So is the bottom is probably a concrete containment. And then the top is wood, or is it metal?
So this building proposal is from a manufacturer called Clearspan. They use metal, usually structure, stainless steel or galvanized pipe, to form the arches, and then the outside covering is a canvas.
Okay. I'll let you ask some questions. Just write them down and keep them up. Okay, give me a couple more minutes. I won't forget about you. So it's a canvas structure. As you said, it's canvas or some kind of membrane.
Correct.
Membrane.
It's sort of triangular shape. It's not rectangular.
All right. And you're gonna bring it in on rail.
So
and when you unload it, is it unloaded by conveyor or is it
right? So our proposal right now to unload is these cars are bottom hopper cars, so they dump out right underneath. There will be a conveyor underneath the rail. From there, it would go right directly through the side of the building, dump in the front corner, and then I would move the salt from the front corner to the back and build the pile from the back to the front.
Okay. And do you draw from, this is curiosity, but do you draw from both sides, or does old salt stay in the back?
This facility, if everything goes well, it would empty out at least once, if not twice, throughout a season.
Other questions from the board? Rich, any questions? Okay, so I'm gonna ask for public input, and we'll go from there. All right, so I'm gonna ask you folks if you want to speak in favor, or if you got a question, just direct it towards me, but they'll answer it. Okay, I just don't want you guys talking back and forth.
So, I'm Steve Assing, I'm a 20-year resident of River Road. This facility is fairly close across the street from me. When we first got the letter, and there's, all the abutters got a registered letter, it stated that it was at 100 Railroad Yard Road, Lot 5, Map 7. That's pretty big. Lot 5 is pretty much the whole railroad yard. There was no statement in there saying that it was going to be on River Road. By the looks of this, you're breaking curb on River Road, per se. So I would say, in fact, that's not 100 Railroad Yard Road. That's going to be River Road. So with that being said, I think a lot of people, abutters, are unknowingly misled as to where exactly this is, unless they looked and saw these plans. So, not a question, just a statement.
And I'll give you an answer in a second, but you got something else in beat.
I've got many questions.
Go ahead. Go ahead, give them to us.
First one was to show me exactly where that is, so I'm pretty much can see where it is now. We're talking about truck traffic and the size of trucks going through. What will the increase in traffic be? We know the size of the trucks, but how many trucks per day, per season? And it leads into a lot of other things. How much noise is that going to make? We've already got a lot of truck traffic at that end of the road. Particularly at the very end, the intersection of 5 and 10. It's really starting to show its wear and tear. We have, all states in there hauling in and out all the time, and we're just going to increase the wear and tear on the road and the traffic, and just concerns, safety concerns, and things like that.
So let me get the answer to that one. So could you can stay there. Just how many trucks you think daily, or can you just give us a seasonal thing? You must know how many tons are going to come in, and if you got a temporary
correct
truck.
So this building is proposed to hold approximately 25,000 tons of salt. Obviously it's dependent on the amount of weather that we have, and also the contracts that are awarded by the cities and towns who would be distributing to from that location. My anticipated project is to have somewhere around 10 to 12 trucks a day work out of there. Average is about 4 loads, so that would be 40 to 12 times 4, another 48. So truck loads in and out
during peak.
Yes, during peak at time.
Okay.
Some days it might be less. Very few days would be more, but that would be around 10 would be the average. And it's not every day. Obviously, it would be again, on the number of contracts. So, for example, if Greenfield orders 100 tons, that's 3 trucks or 3 loads. We're trying to get across the Route 2 corridor with the contracts that we currently have. So,
where do you work out of now?
Our current facility is located in Westfield.
Okay.
I have there's been a salt storage facility down there on Union Street for years, many years.
Yep.
We've taken over management of that about 14 years ago.
Okay. So now that's the, how many trucks? So what else you have?
Is that what I heard right? It could be 48 trucks per day? Is that right?
during peak time. Is that correct?
That's six trucks every hour. That's a pretty good stream of additional traffic. So I got more questions.
Yep, go ahead.
Proceed. So that brings up, with the trucks and whatnot, that brings up noise, odors, fumes. We already have a hard time living there. I realize it's a commercial zone, but, you know, some of us didn't have a choice. We bought a house there, and that's where we are. But I'm concerned with if the salt, I don't know a lot about salt, but does salt produce dust? And will it be free-flowing through the air? The exhaust from the trucks, from idling equipment, bucket loaders, payloaders, whatever it may be, and the fumes from those. And the noise, how, I understand, so they're gonna be bottom-fed hoppers from the railroad going up a conveyor. Is there vibrators involved with that? To shake the cars loose of salt, and salt sticks to the sides of trucks. Noise is a big concern. I mean, we have a lot of noise there already. We don't need to add to it.
So would you answer is there dust out of the salt?
The product that we're going to have up there is, the trade name is Clearlane. It's an enhanced salt product. There is very little dust with this product compared to regular rock salt. It has a liquid mixture into it, so that very dampens the dust. In our experience with doing this product in Westfield, there is no dust compared to, you know, regular rock salt.
And would you address the
As far as vibrators, yes, smell? We do need to have pneumatic vibrators to when the salt doesn't flow. And as far as idling machinery, unfortunately, you know, the bucket loaders are loud. I do maintain my equipment to factory specifications. So, you know, there's no open pipes or open exhaust on any of them. It's all, you know, factory mufflers and everything.
Okay. And an off topic of what he is, what is your lighting going to look like?
Currently, what I'm proposing is to have just some lighting on the scale house building to light up the scale. In that drawing, it would be that small, skinny platform to the left side. And then a couple lights on the unloading area, which would be on the back side of the building facing the railroad tracks, so that for safety reasons, so we can see what we're working on. And then one light on the outside of the building lighting up the doorway, and one light inside for lighting up the inside. The bucket loaders all have lights on them, so we would use those for general lighting inside the buildings.
Yeah, now you give us another one. If you have any more.
I'm good with that.
Okay.
So I think the board should consider the fact that the abutters may have, I'm not saying they were, but may have been misled by the letter. Because even if you Google map 100 Railroad Yard Road, it's at the very corner of McCullen Farm Road and the end of Railroad Yard Road, which is where the bridge goes over the river, the second river, the southern bridge. So if all this was back there, I probably wouldn't be having a problem with it. But it's right in my front door.
Yeah. So I told you I had an answer for you. And I don't mean any disrespect whatsoever in what I say, but you got the letter, you're here. If I lived where you lived and I got anything on that railroad yard, I'd be at the meeting. So they were notified that something was going on at the railroad yard. So I'm not going to get tangled up in real details. But I do have a couple other questions. So I can't, there's not like I'm going to say, oh, let's throw this out because somebody might not have understood.
I'm not saying throw it out. I think you ought to reschedule a meeting so that the people, because I've talked to a lot of people on River Road. I even tried to call the town building inspector and other people involved in town, asking if they knew exactly where this was, and I could not get an exact answer.
So
that's why I'm here.
And that's
to
you
find
were
out where they were actually right. breaking curb.
And you did the right thing. You came here. The other people that don't come here, and I don't mean this again, yep. but it's not our obligation, anybody's here, to hold somebody else's hand. So if they chose not to come, they chose not to come. So,
I don't mean to keep interrupting you, but do you understand that it says 100 Railroad Yard Road? It doesn't say River Road. It doesn't say a number of River Road. So with it being where if you Google map it, and it says, and you think it's where it is, I would say a lot of people wouldn't have any concern. The only concern I had was that there was dig safe marks in the road. And that's what I was wondering what was going on.
And I would say, again, if we go to the assessors, whatever Google says, again, and whatever the internet says is what the internet says. What's on our books in the assessor's office is what's on these papers. So I can't.
Map 7, Lot 5 is the whole railroad yard road.
I understand
even
that.
Even that 100 railroad yard road that Google Maps shows us is part of Lot 5.
Okay. So what we have here also, and we'll go a little further, and I don't know if we'll get to a vote or not today, but whoever didn't show has the ability to do an appeal if they don't like what the outcome is. And I'm not disrespecting anything you're saying. I hear you 100%. But I have a couple more questions for them, and maybe you'll like a couple of these questions. So is this, when you approached Pro-Am or Ampro or whoever owns the railroad now, is this the only site that they offered you, or why didn't they offer you, to his point, the opposite side of the tracks over by where it used to be the old Agway feed shop and so forth? That burned down.
I was, let me back up. Salt City would be the managing company for this salt facility. We are a handler for Cargill De-icing Technologies. Pan Am Southern approached them, Cargill. They are the ones who supply the salt. And had this, to my understanding, Pan Am approached Cargill with this facility, proposed facility site. Because I'm currently the handler for Cargill in Westfield, they asked me if I would take on this as another handling facility. Cargill's policy has been always, for when they do these types of things, the handler who's going to run the facility is the application or the would be the leasee for the property.
So,
just one thing.
Yes.
A number of the concerns that the abutter raises, this site plan still has to go in front of the planning board and also the conservation commission for additional site plan review, where I think a number of the concerns raised would be probably more addressed further.
Yeah, the only problem is, you know what, they don't have any power. All the power's right here. Seriously, this is the only place that can put the conditions and hold the conditions and so forth. And technically, in our process, you're supposed to go to all the boards first and then come here last, is what the technically, if you read what the process is. Many times we go around that because we don't want people spending, if we're going to shoot you down, we really don't want you spending a lot of money on engineering if it's going to be shot down. So my question was, why Pan Am again? So Pan Am is working a deal with Cargill?
To the best of my knowledge, that is the deal. They approached Cargill with a potential of having a facility on this parcel of land, bringing the salt cars in from the mines out in the Midwest.
All right. So I'll be honest with you. When I saw this, my mind went immediately to exactly the opposite side of the tracks, over there where the old Agway building was. Great place, out of the way, and that kind of stuff. My eyes didn't, or my mind didn't go to it on the River Road side. And I do know what you're talking about, the loading dock there. It was a cross-docking scenario,
yes,
is what it was that was there. So that's where my mind went originally. So, all right, so any more questions? Yes.
My name's Amy Schaefer. I've lived on the street for 4 years now. What's the environmental impact of the salt next to the wetlands?
Do you, I'm assuming DEP watches you like a hawk or whatever. You want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so the proposed building is going to be blacktop floor, concrete walls, and all the salt will be from directly from the rail car via conveyor into the building and contained. The trucks will be loaded inside the building and then distribute to their locations.
Right. They're on the upgradient side, and the actual truck maneuvering area of the building are down gradient of the weapons, down basically towards the elevation of the weapon.
Okay, so yeah.
I got another concern. There's the residents in that area, we all get our water, our house water supply by Canyon. It's actually Greenfield town water, and all our water lines. Has that been surveyed at all, the water lines that are running through there?
Yes, there's a water line shown here.
Can I approach that?
Sure.
So here's the platform right now.
Yeah, there's more water lines right in this area right here, too. This is, I believe, Russ Kennedy's house. Well tile right here in the corner that is supplied off of these lines somewhere. We don't know exactly where.
And all the utilities will go through the appropriate sources.
Okay. All right, you got, yes, Mr. Camosa.
Ron, is what's before your variance, is it just the height variance?
Yeah, it's a height in a size of the building.
I just wanted to inform your board that the planning board has discussed the height of the buildings, and we are putting an article on this April town meeting to change that to 50 feet, where people are going to be in probably 70 feet, where it's just the peak of the building where it's an unoccupied structure, just for your information.
Yeah. So it's the size of the building, and it's the size of the size of the building, and it's the height of the building. Okay, so I want to ask if there's any people I want to speak in favor of it. Are you all set, you think, for a minute? Anybody want to speak in favor? Yes.
Mike Tetler, I'm part of the industrial development team with Canyon Southern, and we'd like to speak in favor of the variance.
Okay. So, all right, so we're gonna close, we're going to deliberate, and then we're going to go to vote. And it's gonna. It takes a four to one vote to get a variance. Variances are difficult. They're not the easiest thing to get. And at any time up to our vote, you have the right to withdraw your proposal and go back to the drawing board. And you can withdraw it without prejudice. So that means you can go back and you can do whatever you're doing, you come back to us. If we make a decision, and the decision is one way or the other, you can, if we vote against it, then it sticks. You have to wait multiple years before you can come back here. There's another roundabout process. And if we vote in favor of it, the public has the opportunity within 21 days to appeal in court to the variance and so forth. So I just want to give you that information, and I don't know who's going to make the decision, but before we go to a roll call vote, I will ask, I'll just give you a second to ponder what you want to do. So amongst the board, any conversation, anybody want to state anything?
Ron, I'm not going to participate in the vote. I want Mr. Moody to do it again.
He keeps throwing you under the bus.
asphalt, I think, at the property, as the driveway goes in, I think that's where Lake Asphalt used to operate out of. I could be wrong.
I believe that's the property that's the fenced off just before this lot.
And I think there was some environmental issues with that. I don't know if they've ever been.
Do you think it's a brownfield?
Completely resolved.
To our knowledge, it is not. That's what.
Okay.
I don't know what the story is, but I just want to tell you, I think Allstate Asphalt used to be right next to it. I think it was part of the same railroad property. They just rented.
That's okay. Correct. The Lake Asphalt facility is excluded from the lease area that's on the diagram.
Okay. Right. I just want to make a comment.
Any other questions or anything? Ben? Any questions?
So, you know, I guess the hardship is we'd really have to think about is that site the only site? And I'm not sure I've been
convinced that, yeah. So what Ben was just saying is, you know, in order to grant the variance, it has to be a hardship. And the hardship has to be more than just it costs more money or something like that. It has to be something to do top of, with the land. That's the only land that we can do this on. Is a good example why you would grant a variance. And let me give you an example of a house, you know, a house being built and they want to be closer to the line or whatever than allowed. And there's a big embankment, so they have to build there. It's the land that forces them there versus choice. And in this case, again, we're looking at a height variance. And again, that's operational. And in the past, we have granted height variances throughout the town where places that are not occupied, where, you know, if there's nobody living or working, when I say working, where they're at risk in a high area. And we have done those. But again, whichever way we lean, the petitioners have the ability to withdraw, or the public has the ability to file a variance.
Excuse me, I have one question.
Yes.
On the if you deny the permit for this location because it's one large parcel, if in the future, near future, they decide to move it to the other side of the railroad, would that still be, I couldn't apply because of the, it was denied?
No, you
for,
could, you could, if we denied it, you could go and apply in another site.
Right, but because it's the same parcel number, that's,
yeah,
my question.
That may be a consideration. Yes, if it's listed, if it's going to list 100, if it's going to list 100 or whatever the street is, that the mat and lot, it's going to be the same mat and lot. So more than likely, you won't be able to apply again on that same lot.
Even if it's on the other side
even
of the
Even if it's
road.
On the other side.
Okay.
So
we're just voting on the height, not the location.
No, height. All
the
we're
height
saying
is the height of the building.
Will we allow them to have a variance
on height
greater than 25,
right.
35 feet
yeah.
to 50 feet?
Right.
Because if it weren't for the height increase, this could be done by right?
Also the size. The size is to be 30,000 feet. So it's the size on the lot and the height on the lot.
But the concerns of the abutters would still be the same. The size of the building doesn't matter.
That's
just our job is to just decide the whether the height of the building would be allowed or not.
Right. That's correct.
Or whether they have a convincing case for why it must be so. It must
what?
Be higher than
right.
So. With that, I don't know if you know. I'm gonna give some. We're all done out there. I'm sorry. I'm gonna give some instructions and so forth. But you know, we can go from there. So, Rich, you kind of understand what we're looking at here. And Frank, you understand what we're talking about?
Well, what I understand is they're asking for a variance on the size of the building.
Right.
And that's what we need to grant or not to
that's
grant.
That's correct.
The concerns about the residents and the location and the noise and everything really aren't included or isn't our job here.
Well, we take that in consideration because
right.
if we
right.
wanted to put conditions,
mm-hmm.
if we were to grant them a permit, we would grant them the permit
And then, like I asked about the lighting, mm-hmm. you know, we could make sure that it's all down lighting.
Yeah.
We could make sure, like, the hours of operation that we talked right. about.
The noise, you know, and everything else is somebody else's concern. Right.
And we even have the ability to give, sometimes we can give permits on, they got to come back every now and then, mm-hmm. and if there's complaint and so forth. So I'm going to just give them some instruction, and then we'll mm-hmm. go from there.
Good.
All right. So you folks that are petitioning, I'm going to say that to give a variance is a very difficult thing, and it's not not that I oppose your proposal or anything like that, but if we the board give you a variance, the public can go and file for an appeal, and our likelihood of ever winning an appeal in court is nil, because we don't have enough, as Ben said, we don't have enough here that's the only place in town with the only land that this operation could happen. Now,
and it's not as if they own the land either. If they owned the land and they came to us and said, this is the only piece we own and we can only put our, and we're going to be put out by not being able to do that. But if you're in the process of looking for a...
And I think if this was on the other side of the tracks, that I think the public might have a different viewpoint. And I think also then we might have been able to work through conditions and make it work. My risk is if we go to vote, there's a good chance that you're going to get a no, I think is a good chance. And if we do, and I'm only talking for myself, but if we, the board, do vote in favor of the operation, then you'll probably get a legal battle on your hands for $75. Because all they got to do is go file some paperwork at the courthouse, and then you, the town, and the neighbors will be in a lawsuit. And I'm not trying to say that to scare you. So you can deliberate with your friends for a minute if you need, but it may be in your best interest to withdraw your petition, regroup, and rethink it.
All right, one moment, please.
All right. Or we'll go to a vote.
Feel different than, you know, if someone owned a piece of property and wanted to build their house and couldn't do it because of limitations or whatever. But if you're leasing a piece of property and there's a giant piece of property and there's a better location, then.
So after deliberation, I think we will decide to withdraw the application
without prejudice.
Without prejudice, prepare a larger plan showing the outside facility, where this is the only logical location for this type of facility on the property.
So I would say, and we'll make a motion in a second, I think that's the right thing to do. So would somebody like to make a motion? The motion would be to allow whatever the name of the business is to withdraw their application without prejudice.
I make a motion to allow Salt City to withdraw their application without prejudice.
All right. So, Linda, how do you vote? Yes.
Four.
Frank?
Yeah.
Ben?
Yes.
And myself, yes as well. That's the right thing to do, because you're going to just, I commend you for what you want to do. I don't think it's a bad business and so forth. But I guess I'm just trying to save you some money and save the town some aggravation. All right.
Thank you very much.
And I apologize that it didn't go better. But you're welcome to go, regroup, fill out another application, and come back. All right, just give us one more second now to just fill out this paperwork real quick, and then we'll get to the Cumberland Farms. Hey, guys?
Yes, sir.
If you want, you know, a good approach is to try to get their contact and stuff and work with them. And then sometimes it works out better. Okay?
So we voted to allow them to withdraw.
Withdraw without prejudice.
Should I write that somewhere?
Yeah, you should.
Mr. Chair, can we have this?
Yep, that's fine. Thank you very much. Yes. Technically, we're supposed to have a bunch of them. And they got a couple of them.
It's also kind of hard. Okay, great. Thanks.
All right.
Right, and with the heart, we had one that was just overturned. So we gave somebody a variance for numbers. Overturned by a lawsuit. So, we're being very careful to make sure that they've really proved that there is a true hardship and that there aren't alternatives. Even though the height doesn't seem like
it. Can I get the other people to sign?
I think we've got everybody. Bob did not sign. Oh, no, there's one. Rich.
Rich, you just signed it. All right, you ready, Ben?
Yes, sir.
The Zoning Board of Appeals will hold a public hearing, actually the continuance of the Cumberland Farms case. And in this case, if you recall, there were four members before present. It was Linda, Ben, myself, and Mr. Decker. And you're going to require a home run to get through. You heard my spiel, and you know
Understood.
It legally. So before we go to vote again, I'll give you the opportunity, counsel, to
make a decision
what you want to do.
Understood.
Okay? So last time we left you with a few things to do.
Yes.
Which was get a letter from the police department, get a letter from the fire department, and a couple of other lot of ends.
Sure.
And in the meantime, you went and had a baby.
That's, yes. It was actually right after this hearing, about a couple hours later, my wife went into labor.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
So, all right, so let's go.
And no,
I do
good,
want to
please.
Say that thank you guys for your presentations have been excellent to date.
Of course.
And so let's...
We're happy to do it. So,
move forward.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'm Tom Reedy. I'm an attorney with Bacon Wilson down in Amherst here on behalf of Cumberland Farms. And its application for a special permit for the use as a retail convenience store with automotive service filling station and some additional signage, as well as for a variance from strict enforcement of the zoning bylaw relative to the signage, their internal illumination, site distance or sign distance from the property line and height. With me this evening, you'll remember Phil Henry from Civil Design Group. He's a site engineer, and we've also gladly brought along with us Jason Adams from McMahon Associates, the traffic engineer. So you did ask us, we were here December 1st. We were scheduled for December 15th. We had requested a continuation to today, and so now we're back before you. In the interim, a couple of things have happened. We've made some changes, I think, hopefully to the board's pleasure. We've been in front of the planning board, and we have, I've also been in front of the select board and have gained their support. We've talked to them about the town sign as well. If you recall, there were a couple of options for the town sign. We thought it might have been appropriate to show it to the select board, which we did, and they, if we are fortunate enough to get an approval, if you would condition that approval, you know, subject to the select board kind of effectuating that town sign, if that pleases the board. They, and I can show you which one they thought they liked, and they also mentioned having some changeable component to it, whether it's eye hooks at the bottom of it or actually on the sign itself, something that could change to advertise craft fair, yard sale, flea market, what have you, towards the center of South Deerfield. What we've got, what Phil is showing right there on the bottom is the original proposal. And if you recall, on the original proposal, on the building itself we had, and the canopy we had, that green stripe going around. And it seemed that the board did not appreciate or like that green stripe. It didn't go with the neighborhood or just the kind of the essence of Deerfield. So we have removed from the building, the canopy, et cetera, that green stripe. And so it will only be white. There's no green stripe. I've got some smaller renderings that I can show you to that end. We also heard from the board there. Thank you very much, Phil. Their displeasure with the toggling, I think, was the word that the board used relative to the smart pay member, non-smart pay member, and then a diesel price underneath. What we've gone and done is removed that toggling, removed the electronic message board, which had appeared at the bottom of the sign that would advertise things like milk, $1.99, if we were so lucky, and which would change at a certain frequency. We've eliminated that electronic message board altogether. We've eliminated the toggling from smart pay member to non-smart pay member. We've just put as static, smart pay member, the price, regular, the price, and then just a sign saying we have diesel. So we've taken out any of the changes, and I think that's what the board had asked for. That reduces the square footage of that freestanding sign from, I think, 75 square feet to maybe 61 and a quarter square feet. The height staying the same at the 25 feet, though. As far as the letters, my understanding was they were submitted to the planning department. I don't know if you've seen them. I did have a conversation with Kevin Scarborough today, with Bill Swayze today as well, just to find out if they had any issues. And the police chief, because it's, I think, his father's property, he can opine, so he had his sergeant opine. And I heard from Priscilla today that they had opined. They didn't have any major issues, and I can read. They were just, they wanted us to take a look at, or they said, well, what's going to happen with the traffic at the corner of Route 5 and L? So that's why I think we've, amongst other reasons, brought Jason along. The fire department, what we've said to them is we provided them with a truck turn diagram showing that their largest truck can access the site, traveling south on Route 5, taking a left onto Elm, getting into the property, and then I think looping back out onto that Route 5 right-only exit and traveling back to the fire station. And it can travel within the site just fine, so they were very pleased by that. We're working on a Knox box for them on the outside of the building, and they also just wanted us to have a pre-plan meeting with them, provide them documentation just showing the mechanicals, the fire suppression, et cetera, that we've said we're going to do. As part of this whole process, we've got to go in front of the select board for a license to store flammables and combustibles underground storage tank license. And as part of that, we provide full pump and take plans to the fire department. They look at it, and eventually the fire marshal's office will take a look at all of that as well. And then Kevin Scarborough, he thought it was a good project. I mean, he was pleased with what we were looking to do, especially in that space. And then the select board, as I mentioned, I don't know if, I wasn't able to find a copy of the minutes. I was there December 14th in front of them talking about the sign and also your request for something from them. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if that had been provided. And like I said, I couldn't find the minutes of it, but they did express, and I don't know if Mr. Camosa is still here, but they did express their support for this project and Cumberland's kind of continuation in this community. And I think that was our homework. If there's any questions, we're happy to dive in some more, but at least peripherally, I think that's where we are.
So, well, since our last meeting and so forth, I have done a lot of homework.
Excellent.
And I do have lots of questions myself personally, but I'm going to ask the board if they have any other questions. And I would ask, Rich, you and Frank, if you have a question, mm-hmm. You know, you're free to ask, or you can ask us if we talked about it as well. But they're not going to vote. I'm just
great.
Allowing them to ask
we appreciate
questions,
that.
Okay?
Well,
thanks.
Could
yes,
I,
Linda.
Can I address the height issue on the sign?
Yes.
Because I was not really excited about the 25-foot height. So today I went out and checked Cumberland Farms in the area, in Amherst, and Hadley, and Greenfield, and even the little one in Deerfield, which I still like. But I was impressed by the different kinds of signs that were there, and especially the ones in Amherst and Hadley, because their signs were not, you know, like, can they see this from the highway type thing. They were just like very simply and nicely fit into the neighborhoods that they were in. And they were no taller than, wait a minute, about 10 feet tall. And I understand where you're coming from, and because of the site this is in, and to get as much attention to your facility, drawing people into it, I understand, you know, that part of it. And my concern is in keeping with the character of the town of Deerfield. So just like the one in Hadley, the one in Amherst do, I believe in theirs. And I think from an aesthetic point of view, from a feels good type, you know, sign, that it's not gonna, you're not gonna look at it and go, oh my gosh, what's that doing here? Because it doesn't fit in.
Sure.
So that's where I'm coming from.
And if I may, so just to address those other municipalities' signs, I think, you know, and we face this a lot depending upon what municipality we're in, but it's more of the site and what are the needs of that site. And if you look at this site and the surrounding areas, and you look at the Irving sign and the Red Roof Inn sign, which, I mean, we're not obviously...
We don't ever want to look at that Red Roof sign again.
We're not approaching that. You know, the Hadley is on, it's on Route 9. It's in between, I think, two stop-controlled intersections. It's a lower rate of speed, I believe, and the Amherst one is actually right around the corner from where our office is. And so that also is at a place where there's a lower rate of speed. And I think as far as identification mm-hmm. for the site itself, and with a use like this, because we're looking to show the motoring public what that price is, and because the motoring public is discerning, that's what we think is needed. I think your bylaw allows a 20-foot high sign mm-hmm. by right. And so we're asking for that additional 5 feet because we think it improves the visibility, but also the safety associated with that visibility, because then the motoring public is going to know sooner on twofold. So not only are those consumers who think that they may want gas and are looking for that gas price going to be able to say, whoa, look at Cumberland, that's a nice price I'm going to pull in, but it's also for those people who aren't going to pull in. They understand that there's a Cumberland Farms there and that people may be pulling in, so they can kind of instinctually slow and do what they need to do vehicular-wise to allow whatever the people in front of them or behind them, probably in front of them, are going to do. So if I'm behind somebody and I see them kind of tapping their brakes, I think, okay, there's a Cumberland Farms, or they may be pulling in because they want gas. So it gives an alert to both the people who are going to go in and also those people who aren't going to go in. So, I mean, I think the other piece with this site is its distance from the roadway. So DOT owns a good chunk of that roadway from the right-of-way. So there's a right-of-way, and then there's a significant distance until you actually get to the property line. And so that's one of the other pieces here, is to be able to allow those northerly bound and even southerly bound, but I think northerly bound traffic, the ability to see that Cumberland Farms. I mean, that's what we're looking to do here. So I can appreciate, I mean, you could look at, let's say, Northborough in the central part of the state, juxtapose that against West Boylston. West Boylston is on a roadway more like this. Northborough is in a town center, so something similar to where the existing Cumberland Farms is, and that has more of a pedestal sign, monument sign, as compared to something like this. So we do it if we think it's appropriate, but in this, we just don't think it's appropriate.
Thank you, Peter.
Sorry, yeah.
And I remember in the last time that we were here, you spoke about the grade of the sign, too. It was already down from the highway or from the
surface,
5 to 10.
Correct.
So I do sort of get that. And so the sign square footage is being reduced. Is there
correct.
Still variance necessary for the square? There is.
For the height? For the overall and signage on the site and the height.
And the height still. So
yes.
We still have both.
And we also still have internal lighting.
Correct.
Correct. So, Tucker, you got any questions before I start my long list?
You should listen to your long list.
Okay.
Very efficient.
Have you received your permit from the state DOT yet?
Great question. I'm going to turn it over to the smarter guy for that.
No, we have not. The state DOT permit will not be issued until we have received local approval. So we've had conversations with the state. We've shared our site plan as it currently exists. But until everything's worked out at the local level and the state is comfortable that the local municipality is comfortable with the project as a whole, they're not going to proceed with their permitting.
And your name, I'm sorry?
Jason Adams.
Jason.
From McMahon Associates.
Thank you.
So with that said, on Route 5, when you exit the property, you're coming out of the property into a right-hand turn only lane with a dotted line for approximately 50 feet
right.
to get over to the left. Otherwise, you're going to drive in circles.
Right.
So you've got literally from here to that wall to get into the left lane, and it before you can go north. So that's one concern.
To the leftmost lane?
To be able to go legally. To legally to be able to
be
go straight.
Lane. Right.
You got from here to the wall
right.
at max.
Right.
Before you're on a solid white line.
Yep.
A lot of people, and here I'm going to preach, but a lot of people don't know what a solid white line means. It means you don't cross
right.
it.
Right. Right.
So, you know, so I'm just pointing that out, that
yep.
there's that concern of come out, get me over there, and by the way, I can't stop here and hold up all the mm-hmm. right-hand turn only stuff.
Could I just jump in on
sure.
that? Because one of the benefits of this site is how straight Route 5 is in this area. So the ability for that driver to see oncoming traffic and to make an appropriate decision is a really great benefit of the layout of this site. So we've brought the driveway right up to the roadway. There'll be a clear visibility and much more than it's required in terms of site distance. To make the decision. So our expectation is that the drivers that understand how this roadway works, and it's pretty apparent, but of course there are new drivers that will be visiting the site, are going to have a great deal of time to make the appropriate decision to enter the flow of traffic at the right time. So if there are vehicles traveling in that through lane, that's going to be apparent from hundreds of feet down the road, and those vehicles can then make the decision to not enter until it is safe for them to be able to get into their appropriate lane of choice.
So I just wanted to point that out, because I've actually made
yep.
calls to the state as well, finding out where are we
great.
In this process.
Have they responded?
They responded that it's in Boston waiting to be approved
right.
in Boston.
Yes.
So the other concern that I have is when you're on Elm Street, and I will say this publicly, I'm very disappointed in our highway superintendent and anybody else that thinks that exit onto Elm Street is a safe exit. Once again, I drive by there twice a day. I drive by there twice a day, minimum. And that's on 5 days, and on the weekends it could be more. And I have experienced it, and you get the stakes there, which is great because I get to see the stakes. And if you're trying to quickly cut in front of vehicles coming such that you don't get rear-ended by somebody behind you, like that, you're into that driveway on the north side of the property. So That's a real big hang-up that I have. I personally have a problem with that. So I know what the purpose of the parking lot was to the side. I think I might have different, if you shove that exit all the way against the property line to the east, I'd have a little bit more heart. But right now, currently, where that exit is, there's no way, this is Ron, my personal vote, I couldn't vote for that project to exit there. And we've cited a couple of situations. It's in Greenfield, I don't know where you guys live and so forth, but if you live in Greenfield, there's a Dunkin' Donuts right off the Mohawk Trail, right on the corner of, I think it's called Mill Street, and it's a real bottleneck. And the other one that I've recited is in Northampton, the Pride Station. And I'll even go in your neighborhood, the Cumberland Farms at Belchertown Road and Southeast Street, the one she's talking about today. All of those are really poor exits and egresses for the access. And I know I read the traffic report and all that kind of stuff, and you know, there's the higher loads in the morning and so forth. The other day I went through it again, and you know what time the school bus goes through there? There's a school bus that comes from Elm Street, and it goes across there, and it goes across two times, approximately 7:30 and approximately 8:30, which is whose peak operation? That would be your peak operation. So, you know, if I think of the school buses going across there, and I know there's a lot of good drivers in the world, but there's an awful lot of bad ones. And you know, there's impatient ones, there's cell phones, there's all kinds of things. So that exit to North, I really think needs to be addressed. I think that, you know, as I've said in the last ones, I have no problem with Cumberland Farms. I'm happy about Cumberland Farms. I think you did a beautiful design there. I think you'll serve a need. Now, I would ask, and I'm not even going to go on this, but I would ask how much of a need, considering there's a gas station, there's five gas stations in this town, and there's three, well, not in this town. Within a mile, there's three gas stations. There's a Circle K, mm-hmm. where the Dunkin' Donuts is. There's what we call, there's a place right as you turn onto 116. Mm-hmm. There's the filling station across the bridge. There's up on 116 going towards Conway, there's a gas station. And at the north end of town, there's a gas station. The town of Sunderland has one gas station, and it's on the Amherst line. Mm-hmm. You drive right by it. Mm-hmm. So when you talk about the need and so forth of the town and the social stuff, do we really need it? I'm not sure we really need it, but I really don't care about that. So when we go to the list down, the list of what are the things why we pass a special permit and so forth, you know, all those things are consideration. Right now, the only thing that I have a real problem with is traffic. That's the really, and traffic and its egress. It's not even traffic. It's not the amount of cars. It's just the safety of the egresses.
Proximity to that intersection.
To that, right. Yeah. You know, I was there the other day, 53-foot tractor trailers in that other lane by the bank. You can't exit. You can't exit. And then, you know, I know Mr. Swayze, that's chief, mm-hmm. said he can bring the fire truck in there. Yeah, well, he can bring the fire truck in there if there's nothing blocking in any way, shape, or form. So I got a real concern with that, that egress on the north side. And I can, and no disrespect to you as an engineer, my background is engineering as well. And the numbers, I can paint them any way I want to paint the numbers. But when you sit there and you see it and you experience it, then that's the reality. And I have to stand for the best of the town.
Is there any way to get you off that position?
Yeah, I think I think you need to move that driveway against the south, against the not the south, but the east
side?
Border. That would be the only.
There's no way to convince you to keep it where it is if he
not. Well, let me put it. That's my vote only. Right. My vote right now.
It's unanimity or nothing for us.
Huh?
It's unanimity or nothing for us right now.
That's correct. Or you can withdraw.
Right.
And you can come back and do the show with five of us.
Five, right.
And then
you can continue to
then you can go from
say
there.
What,
but,
and then we need to.
Right. But I think that exit where it is, and I'm very, very surprised that as many people have looked at this plan, the fire chief, the police department, the DPW, this would hold up good for you maybe in court, but the DPW looked at that plan and think that that's a good idea.
Right. You know, I think if Jason can probably speak to it, but just about the design principles associated with where to site it in relation to what currently exists on the northerly side of Elm Street. And I think that's really what drove this siting of it.
Right.
The bank.
Just from an access management point of view, which is important. It's not obviously the only consideration, but being able to line the Cumberland Farms driveway up with one of the existing bank driveways. Obviously, we can't line it up with the driveway that's further away from the intersection because it extends past our property. So being able to line it up within the same area of the bank is a positive from an access management point. It gives the exiting vehicles from both businesses a better view of each other, and also doesn't give you curb cut, you know, and kind of just constant interaction for the vehicles traveling on Elm Street. So the location of this driveway here, you know, while it is in relative close proximity to the signal, and we certainly understand your concern there, we do feel it's a benefit to, from an access management point, to reduce the number of different conflict points for both the vehicles exiting our site, as well as, and more importantly, for the vehicles on Elm Street. So that's kind of a key for where we wanted to line this up, knowing that we couldn't reach the other access point for the bank. I think another important thing to note with this site is it does have two access points onto two different roadways, and that's not the case for every site of this nature. So if there were to be additional congestion at this particular driveway, the vehicles, aside from those that want to travel south on Route 5,
there's only one exit to go south.
What's that?
There's only one exit to go south.
So the vehicles that need to go south would have to exit this driveway. Mm-hmm. All the other vehicles could exit from the driveway onto Route 5 if that was a more desirable way to exit. And our experience in doing a number of these sites is that they are a convenience type of use, so that I'm not going to go to a gas station or to get my coffee at a time that's going to incur a lot of additional delay to me as a consumer. If this driveway was difficult to get out of, I would seek an alternative route, i.e. the driveway onto Route 5, or I'd seek an alternative time to visit the site. And, you know, it's our collective thinking and Cumberland Farms' experience that this project site is going to be able to serve its customers in an appropriate manner, and we feel from a traffic and safety perspective that's a true statement. If there were to be congestion beyond what we expect and what Cumberland Farms expects in their business model, you know, you do have a release valve onto a different roadway.
I understand that, but my 50 years of driving and, you know, and living there and knowing the community, I would say that the driveway's position is not a safe environment. And I'll give you my, again, if somebody pulls out and they're halfway in the lane and somebody comes around that corner, you stop everything. You stop traffic flow from the right turn on red. You stop the flow in and so forth. It, again, I'm in support of the project, and I wish there was a bridge going over and you could get out of there. But I look at it every day I drive by it, and I keep coming back to that. And so I have a real problem with that from an access point of view. And I will say this to you, once again, and I'm surprised again at other people who haven't said something, and I think there's a fear factor here for people to speak openly. Well, I'm not afraid of anything, so they're afraid to speak, but I do get this from the public that I run into, and they say, what's going on? I can tell you I was at a Christmas party, and there's people watching this show now, and they come up to me, and they go, what are they thinking? And, you know, so I'm here to represent the townsfolks and what's really good for the town. And I'm not going to say that I don't think that I'll get to you when I can get. What I think is it's a good thing for the town, but the safety of the town, and when I see the, like I said, the buses and that type of stuff there, it becomes a danger.
Point. If they were to put an additional egress out on the east line, okay, and just made this other one just an ingress, would that solve the problem, or you don't think it would? Just thinking out loud.
So well, right in only in about the same location where this currently is, and then either an exit only or full access further to the east?
An exit only to the east.
I have a question about the orientation of the site. Because I'm looking at it now, and I'm wondering if you're trying to make that access further east, would it be possible to
tweak it a little bit?
Yeah, to tweak the whole site alignment so that I know your traffic flow was your main reason for, you know, wanting to be able to come through that pump road there and go in and out. Is there a reason that it's oriented the way that it is to Elm Street more so than to 5 and 10?
Well, we typically line up the sites, you know, perpendicular. For more or less, this site is a rectangle. Obviously, there's a little bit of a hitch in the property line, but we lay out our sites where the main entrance faces the main road and where the pumps are. But so that's why I think tweaking it or putting it at any sort of angle that's not 90 or completely rotated 90, like we would never rotate this 90 so it faces Elm Street.
Or 45 degrees. He's saying yeah, we would go 30 degrees or something.
We very rarely consider a 45 degree because it creates other challenges geometrically. You lose efficiencies in the layout.
Do you know what I mean, though, about the way that Elm and 5 and 10 are coming together here? Is there any reason to not have it perpendicular to 5 and 10?
Rotate at 90.
I see what you're saying, but we're really aligning it
with Elm Street.
Off of this property line here.
I see. Oh, that's some state property?
That's Route 5 and 10.
I see.
So that's what we're building this off of.
Interesting.
It just so happens that this line is pretty much perpendicular to this line.
Right.
So we wouldn't consider probably rotating it to like say this line, but to your point, you know, like most things, right? There's trade-offs and effects, right? So if we were to entertain an entrance, say a full access over here, entrance and exit. There are other obstacles that would come into play, most notably the truck circulation, right? So right now this truck comes in here and makes a series of left-hand turns, which is the easiest movements for a tractor-trailer. And it allows this tractor-trailer, this unloader, to unload on the right-hand side in a protected fashion, right? So from a circulation standpoint, this is ideal from a tractor standpoint. So potentially closing this up or making, say, an entrance only here, a right-in only, not even an entrance, a right-in only, which usually is a very preferred movement, right? It takes vehicles off the road without queuing on site. So there's never a chance where this guy's stopping on the road waiting to get in, right? So that's usually a preferred movement. So say we do a right-in only here, we now have to negotiate this tractor trailer out. So just looking at this, talking about it as I'm thinking of it, you know, a right-hand turn coupled with a left-hand turn could be very difficult. However, we would need to essentially take this row of parking in this building and start sliding it independently and leaving everything else the same to essentially widen this curb cut, or widen this access route, I should say, so it doesn't start clipping and introducing another safety hazard with trucks sideswiping vehicles or interacting with sidewalks. The planning board had mentioned introducing a sidewalk here coming from town center. We have not installed that yet because we wanted to have an open discussion about the curb cut. So that would also be a consideration not to move a curb cut here just for the pedestrians coming in from town center. So there's causes and effects. I think we need to consider, okay, eliminate this, but what else does that affect? So if left-hand turns were allowed here and this wasn't a 50-foot wide road, I think that this would be a much easier conversation because now if you're at this dispenser, in order to go southbound, you have to come out here, wait at this light, and go. So it's
you have to do that today. Not out of there, but out of that same.
Out of here. So
that's correct.
It's just decreasing the convenience factor that much more, which we consider that as well as safety and all the other things that we're supposed to consider. So it's just a cause and effect. So not to say that nothing's insurmountable, right? So it's just talking through things and seeing what's the best option considering all movements, all functions.
Okay.
This tractor trail also making this right and making this left would probably reduce some of that parking over there too, which so, obviously we want to maintain.
All right. What about, do you count parking at the pumps?
Well, this is a problem what we have. And you know, you're going to hit, if you go to, again, Circle K down the road, people's right to park at the pumps and go in and get Dunkin' Donuts.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's, you know, that I worry about, you know, 8 pumps. I don't care. It's not a big deal. It's a little bit rude for people to just pull up. And people don't even buy gas. I watch them pull up, and they just get out and go inside. And, you know, I don't want to say they're jerks, but they're they're jerks. And they go in, and why do they do that? Because they can.
They can. Yeah.
And so, yeah, you're going to have the same thing happen here.
Yeah.
You know, people are going to pull up those pumps, and there's 16 spaces. If you look at the pumps, technically there's 16 spaces.
There's...
Those are just single guys.
Oh, they're just single pumps?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
One on each side, so 8.
Okay, so
I'm just concerned with if we're talking about starting to open up a curb cut all the way to the east, do a right-in only, eliminate some of the parking to allow appropriate delivery and other site circulation. That's loss of parking spaces, and that kind of...
I'd rather give you a waiver for loss of parking spaces in lieu of a safe exit than to...
Is there room for parking on the others on the south side of the building?
Where your tanks are and the pad.
With a detention basin.
Oh.
So... it would just get that in much closer to the wetlands.
What?
So obviously we're in front of conservation. There's been a lot of discussion about the stormwater management and groundwater, and it's been a challenge to get the grading to work because the site is flat, plus it's 3 feet lower than the road. So there's been a lot of, you know, manipulation and give and take. So what I just mentioned about sliding that pave or the building and that adjacent row would obviously increase impervious, which would create more of the need to manage stormwater. So introducing spaces on the southerly end would create more impervious. So again, it just speaks to, you know, what's the trade-off and what's the best solution.
So I don't know if you know the answer to this or not, if you have a hydraulic that did analysis. Where those tanks go, those tanks are going. And again, if the water table's fairly high, which we have to assume it is because the wetlands behind it, the tanks are substantial in size. You know, I've dealt with tanks. There's actually going to be weights on them to hold them down.
Oh yeah, they'll be dead man's traps.
So they'll be, and pray that they never break because they'll come up like a bottle in water.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So, any questions? Because I'll ask the public in a second.
My only comment is that design's a lot better than what's going on in the center of town right now. I mean, the one shortcoming about the business on Elm Street is a lot easier to deal with than what's going on in the center of town now with the way the Cumberlands is set up. To me, that's far more dangerous, working two doors down from them.
Mm-hmm. Any questions, Robert?
I think the only other thing I had was I'd like to see some sort of a crosswalk so that if people came from Elm Circle across and they wanted to go to Cumberland, that they didn't get picked off.
From my understanding, you are providing a crosswalk with a crosslight with a button and...
Yeah, are you talking like a mid-block crosswalk or one at the intersection?
No, from
I'm talking about so somebody when they cross the street.
The bank side.
From the bank.
From the bank.
Right? And then if they want to cross the street, yes, the kids,
want to run down there.
Press the button.
Is there going to be a place where they can get across without getting killed, providing you push the button? If they don't push the button, it's their own fault.
Well, there is on the north side to go like directly across to the vet clinic because there's a sidewalk there. There isn't a sidewalk on the other side.
It'll be all up to state code.
It's going to be there.
Yeah.
You agree?
Yeah. We were.
Yeah, that was a requirement of MassDOT. That was one of the first things that they spoke to us about would be the installation of a crosswalk and as well as the new pedestrian signal head so that we would actually, as part of this project, if it were to move forward, reinstall the countdown signal heads, which are becoming standard throughout the state. So it's going to be an upgrade of the existing facility crossing Route 5 as well as a new pedestrian facility crossing Elm Street.
And those crosswalks, at least under your domain, not the one on the other side of the street, will be ADA.
We will be replacing the pedestrian equipment, the signal heads, across the street as well.
But how about at the street? Are the corners going to be ADA compliant?
Yes.
With the
vision. As soon as we touch it, MassDOT will require that we upgrade everything. So there'll be ramps across Elm Street on our site side, and it'll be the new facility crossing Route 5, replacing the existing facility that's there to cross pedestrians. So it'll be a rather significant upgrade for pedestrians at this intersection should the project move forward.
Along those same lines, we talked last time you guys were here that the existing site, you're going to clean it up, obviously, mm-hmm. and you cleaned up it well. It was a brownfield for a while. Mm-hmm. And then you're going to put it up for sale. And you talked about, I don't know if you talked about it or whether this is stuff I heard through grapevines, you're going to put restrictions on, deed restrictions, such that people can't build what there?
Gas station, convenience store.
No store.
Convenience store. So I think it's anything that would reasonably compete with what Cumberland Farms does is what they're looking to prevent. Mm-hmm. So I think we've got, through the building commissioner, the number for Wolfie's, Mr. Wolfram. So we haven't reached out to him yet because we need to see what happens here, Planning Board, Conservation Commission. But we know the importance to the town of not having this, and we don't want to have this sit there empty, vacant, what have you. So after we clean it up, they look to sell it as quickly as possible. They don't like to lease. They don't want to be a landlord. So mm-hmm. it's something that's definitely on the radar, but we just haven't gone to that next step because we think it's a little premature.
Yeah, I really don't have a problem with the deed restriction as far as the gas, but I have a little bit of a problem with the deed restriction as far as controlling that somebody can't open a store there. A mom and pop store. We had at one time we had three mom and pops, four mom and pop stores, right there in the center of town.
Yeah, seven at one time.
Seven of them, and they were small little grocery stores and so forth. And right now, you know how many we have? Do we have any? None. These are family names that are still here in town that had those stores, and they were beautiful stores. I'm talking beautiful little stores. But if you say to us we can't have a store, that really limits our ability to have a small neighborhood grocery store. And it also allows one of the existing landlords to really increase their cost, which will not allow other people to develop. So, I mean, I would ask you to maybe... No gas, great. But as far as, you know, somebody opening up a small grocery store or something, that'd be really sad that we couldn't do that in the center of town. So, okay. So, if anybody other questions?
No, I don't have any questions. I was going to try to see if Linda still had problems with the sign, whether she wanted it the height brought down a little bit, or are we going to maybe satisfy it? This point, so that we have to get consensus where all four of us are on the same page.
Am I satisfied with a 25-foot sign? Is that the question? The signage, the 25-foot?
Yeah, are you? Yeah. You're not okay with that, or are you? Okay. So, All right, we're going to let us ask the public, and then we'll go to a little deliberation. And once again, Counselor, you have the ability to withdraw before we go to a vote, or even before we go to a vote, if you want to have another continuance, we'll do another continuance, okay. All right? Mr. Camoso.
Yeah, as a select board member, we did comment on this, and we spoke about it generally as well. And the board is very much in favor of this, you know, development. We think that it would serve a great need for the community. We're very much behind it. Now, I'll take that hat off. I've also lived for 45 years, and we have over 8,000 cars registered right here in Deerfield. We do need another gas station. I mean, I don't buy a lot of gas locally because it just so happens when I'm going, I can't get into Circle K or the little one up there, or even Cumberland Farms is bumper to bumper. So I usually buy my gas on the road. I really think there's a big need for that. And as Frank alluded to, I can respect some of your concerns, Mark, but you've got the bank right across the street. When you try to leave that bank, you could use the same argument. When you try to take a left out of there, cars are coming around. The big advantage to this, if you want to look at this, is at that intersection, cars are usually going slower. When you're at the Irving station, it's a traffic nightmare when you're in there, trying to get out, trying to make a left hand turn. You're literally trying to get between cars that are already going 40 miles an hour. And at the same gas station up on 116, when you're pulling out there, you've got cars coming over the bridge that make it difficult to see, or cars that are already traveling around the corner and now are accelerating to 30 miles an hour. At least here, everybody's going slow. Is it perfect? No, but it's a lot better than what we got. And I think that, given all of the things that they've put before us, I don't see that it's a real bad, design. As far as the sign goes, 25 feet seems high, but if you're coming down Route 5 and there's a tractor trailer truck sitting there that's 13 feet high and you're sitting down in your car, you're still not going to see the entire sign of being 25 feet, because like they said, it's already sitting, 3 or 4 feet in a hole to be starting it. And it's not a very large sign. You mentioned the sign at Cumberland Farms and Renamers, it's lower, but it's also twice as wide as this. And, I think that particular sign is a little more obstructive because when you pull out, it's right in your line of vision, so you have to pull out into the road to see around the sign. You can't look underneath it. And this particular one is held up by, I know it's one unit, but there's two columns, so you can see through it better. And the sign actually is higher than here. Mike.
Thank you. Anybody else want to speak in favor? Mr. Pachurk.
The only thing I want to say is that I think this would be a good project for the town. The town typically has had a max of like 28 to 29% commercial industrial tax base. Right now we're down to like 21, 22%. And I think we've got to do whatever we can do to try and get the commercial industrial tax base back up, because that saves everybody's taxes. It helps supplement your taxes, everybody's taxes in town. Also, it's good for the economy because they're going to have to hire a couple more people. They're not going to run this kind of gas station with no help. You've got to have help to run the gas station. So initially I was agreeing that the curb cut should be moved down to the east part of the thing. But after listening to all their logic, even though I thought that at first, I think I would agree that that would probably be the best way to get people in and out. And as Kippy says, it's a lot slower traffic right there because of going in and out. And I go in and out of that bank all the time, so I know what that's all about. And also, like Frankie said, it's a lot better than what we have in the center of town right now. Because I walk that route all the time, and I watch out for traffic like you can't believe, and I'm only walking.
Okay. Anybody else that wants to speak in favor? Anybody want to speak in opposition?
Can I just make one point about the assessed value of the existing site versus what this will likely be assessed at? So the existing site, I think, is $285,500 at a tax rate, not talking about any of the water or the fires. At $15.25 per thousand, that's about $4,300 some odd dollars per year. For this once this, if this is approved, we're talking about maybe the average over, we looked at five different sites, was anywhere from, you know, maybe $1.4, $1.5 million, which at that same tax rate is about $23,000 annually. So about a four-time increase over what's existing. So just something else to think about. And the lack of drain on town services, something like this, brings with it.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So I'm going to just make one more comment, and then we'll go to vote, or you can do what you want to do. So I understand and hear what they say. I can tell you right now, this town is becoming like Amherst, spending money. My taxes in this town are so high right now, they're going to drive me out of this town. And the reason being is because foolish spending in other places. So although it's good we're going to get more money in, and I want more money, but until we get our spending under control with some of the bad things we're doing in this town and where it occurs to spending, then I don't really want to say it matters. Because if you get more money and then I'm going to go spend it on crazy projects, and I don't want to list them because they're here, and they're not real, we're wasting money. And it goes through different lots of different organizations. And the community needs to worry about the community and not the county or the world. Worry about the town. The elder select board members that used to be in place had a lot better control under this town than this town has been controlled in the last several years. So I agree 100%. I agree that it's beautiful. I think that it's a great business. I agree that we're going to bring jobs there and so forth. But I can't vote personally, not the board. I personally cannot vote for that egress where it is and sleep at night and live here and watch that as the hazard that it is. So from my point of view, we can go to vote for the four. We're going to address that egress, or you can continue or withdraw, and you can get another five members and hope that somebody else here doesn't feel the same way that I do. I do agree with what they said. The sign, I don't think, I know it's a little tall. I don't think it's, you know, 20 versus 25. We're talking 5 feet. It's submerged. I don't think the sign's a big thing. I think that Cumberland Farms has done a great job presenting and designing the project and so forth. I support it 100%, but I can't support that egress. And I'm very, very surprised that the state is even giving you the curb cut that they're giving you, because up north where the fire station is, the state has given several people in this town hard times and not has given them curb cuts and denied curb cuts. And our own fire department has made it such that a neighbor can't use the property of the fire department to egress, which would be safer for part of the street to come out through the fire department. And they've not allowed that. So don't take it this way. And I don't know whether the state is working with Cumberland Farms or why they're lenient on Cumberland Farms, but other people, and I can cite 3 to 4 places that the state has not allowed curb cuts on Route 5. So again, I support it 100%. I do not support that egress.
If we could.
Yeah, just a point of clarification about the state. They haven't granted us this curb cut at this point. It still does need to undergo a very thorough review. So we've had preliminary discussions. Preliminarily, they've given us some comments and feedback about the driveway onto Route 5, the driveway onto Elm Street, the improvements at the signalized intersection. But we don't have any kind of positive, this is approved. So regardless of, you know, what happens here, we would still need to move forward with the state and go through that thorough review. And there very well may be things that come out of that review that are similar to points that you're raising as well. So there is somewhat of a secondary review of these improvements and of this project as a whole that has not taken place. So I just wanted to make that point of clarification that the state has not approved this driveway and still would need to make sure that they're comfortable with the drive as well.
On the state road. And the reason I say that is when I called the state, they told us that Elm Street is our jurisdiction, not the state's jurisdiction. And believe me, I was praying it was their jurisdiction. So I didn't have to be the person to stand up here and say this.
Yeah, and I think Jason was saying that they do look at the surrounding access.
We would expect to receive comments about the site as a whole, because they can't really just look at it as one driveway. So they can't enforce, per se, what happens on Elm Street, because that is town jurisdiction, so that is outside of their jurisdiction. But given the proximity to the state layout and how the site abuts the state layout, they still have a very big concern overall about how the site operates. So if this project didn't have an access onto Route 5 directly, we would still need a state permit because of it's abutting the state layout. So they're, while they can't enforce anything about Elm Street because it is your jurisdiction, they certainly can comment on Elm Street. They certainly can hold up our approval if they had concerns about Elm Street and how the project is going to interact with their roadway, which is directly abutting Elm Street and the project site.
So I think what I like to do is, if possible, get some comment from the balance of the board. So,
okay.
Because I think my sense is probably request a continuation, then think about if we want to withdraw, but at least get us on that other agenda, maybe in the interim say, let's file a letter requesting withdrawal without prejudice, file a new application if we think that that's the best way to go. But for us to go back, because we're going to have to take these comments, go back to Cumberland Farms and say, hey, this is what we're hearing. What do you think about?
Would you like us to take a straw vote?
A straw, as long as it's only straw, yeah.
No, seriously. That's legal. Yeah. We can take a straw vote if you wanted to, and we can take a straw vote on both subjects.
That would be fantastic. And then any comments, because I know.
Now, not to say that a straw vote, again, is going to bind, because they get the right to change their mind.
Of course.
They can tell you one thing and then change their mind.
Right. But just if there's anything else that we need to think about or address, and then, what if we do go right in only to the westerly side? If we can work it with the site layout and then do a full access further to the east, is that something that not only you but the balance of the board could see fit to approve? I mean, that's because we like seeing you, but I don't think we want to keep coming back over and over again.
Nor do I want to hold you up. I just really wish the state had weighed in.
And that's not going to happen.
Right.
Is that true that's not going to happen until
the state?
The local?
Right. For us to get a decision from the state, we have to have a local approval.
And is that from all local entities?
Yes. Right. So we would need to be fully approved at the local level before MassDOT will issue their decision.
And I know, Ron, you brought up concerns about the right out. Are you feeling better about that, about the turning right onto 5
and
10?
What my heartburn is that exit going south. You're go look at the bank where the bank is. You're approximately 80 feet from the main road. So once again, if you've got perfect drivers and they abide by the laws and so forth, then it works. But if you get, I want to be careful with who I say or whatever I say, they come out and they're blocking the road. You got, and I counted tonight, less than 2 seconds when I came down here. I took a left turn there. It's less than 2 seconds to react to that driveway. So I just think that that whole driveway has to move to the west, side of the property. And I'd rather see more parking where the proposed Deerfield's sign is going to be and so forth. Closer to the road, more parking.
Over in that northwest corner.
That's correct, up in the northwest corner. If they want additional parking. again, I support the project to hold.
Right.
I can tell you this, if there's four other people and they vote yes, fantastic. The way I vote is the way I can sleep at night.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, again, I hound it, but I've been here 40 years doing this, literally, on this board.
Well, I mean, we're also dealing on a technical level because of the addition of a couple of new associate members, and town council has opined that if we do want their input, then we've got to withdraw and resubmit.
That's
so
correct.
I think that's why I'd like to kind
you
of
continue,
have my cake.
You?
Well, I want my, yeah, I
well,
want to have my cake
you
and eat
let's
it too.
Do a, let us do a straw vote.
That would be fantastic. And get us some direction, because if it can be a continuation where we have the four that's already existing, then I think we've hastened where we're getting to the decision as compared with.
So
if we just go back and can't do it, then we'll probably withdraw and
so
see.
So we're going to take two straw votes.
Fantastic.
The one straw vote is all to do with the height of the sign, the interior lighting of the sign, and the quantity of signs on the property.
The
you
sign
agree,
area,
Council?
Yeah, and also the proximity of the directional signs to the property lines. Those are the ones that are the 3.5 foot high, welcome, see you soon. And then also the freestanding sign, because if you look at where the layout of the street is compared with the layout of the property line is, we're technically too close to the property line. It requires 20 feet, but the only effective way to do it is to be too close. So it's that one, and then also to allow a direction, a true directional sign, because we have those.
Yeah, I'm okay with that.
You know, the South Council. Deerfield Village, Mount Sugar. This is the one that the select board liked, by the way. It was the one with the wood and then maybe some eye hooks at the bottom. So
the first straw vote is signage and height of sign. So we'll do a straw vote. And Linda, how do you vote on that? No. Ben?
I would vote yes on the signs.
I would vote yes on the signs. Robert?
Yeah, I think that the sign is probably fine, but, you know, maybe they might want to bring it down a little bit. But.
Okay, so you got a, you lost on that one. All right, so now let's go to the.
Is there any way to get the other members' input as well?
I don't want to do that to them.
Okay.
I want them to be able to make their. If we go back and you withdraw, we go to five. I'd like to have them make that decision and have all the facts.
Okay.
So the next one is about the egress.
20 feet is.
Where the existing egresses are. And this is the special permit, actually, what we're talking about. It's not even the egress. It's really a special permit to operate this on that site is what we're really voting about. The controversy we had a little bit is about the egress.
Sure.
And under the bylaw, there's the five categories that you have to, social characteristic, the safety, don't tax the utilities, public safety, there's the five criteria there. So with that said, how would you, again, straw vote, how would you vote from a straw vote point of view, whether you would approve this as the existing design shows. Linda?
No.
Ben?
I think I could be convinced of it if I felt like everybody, I felt that the town was supportive of it. And I don't know enough about traffic, and I haven't studied it like you have, so I can't say that the thought of that as opposed to the bank one, I don't understand why this one is so much more dangerous. So if nobody else was speaking in opposition that we're sending in letters and such, I think I could be convinced to be okay with it.
I say no, and it's all about the egress. And it's because of going south. That's the only, it's not even the going north is, not north, but going west is not a problem.
Okay.
Robert?
Somebody coming out, and people tend to sit there and wait for the guy to get out, right? So the guy's turning to go towards 5 and 10,
it could be time crunch and somebody might get hit in the rear in the process. I can see the safety valve. But if 75, 80 feet further down, there's going to be more of a distract so that there wouldn't be as big a problem. It takes a variance in the size of the building. That's what they're asking for. And they're also asking for a special permit to have the gasoline. The whole laundry list is stuff that they're asking for.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have a problem with the concept, but I just think that I'd like to see the safety stuff tweaked a little bit. And as for the sign, I can live with it, but it might be, I don't think it needs to be quite that high, but I can live with it.
So I guess to put a, two things, to put a finer point on it, there's no variance for the size of the building. It's a special permit if we're over the 4,000 square feet. And I guess we would just ask you to recall the dip in the site with the height of the sign. So if you allow 20 feet by right and under your zoning bylaw, and we've got a 2 to 3 foot dip there, and we're asking for 25, we're essentially at 22. To require us to have the 20 would bring us down to, say, 17, which is below what would be allowed by right. So that's kind of the thinking with that. So again, understanding that, I mean, we're going to ask for a continuation. I think it's probably pretty clear about that by this point. But then it's finding out, is there, if I may, a height for the sign that you would be comfortable with, above 20, below 25, or is it all or nothing?
Council, something that's been done in the past is people float the balloon. They float the balloon. They take a balloon on a flag and they float it 25 feet.
Sure.
And it's a good visual.
Sure.
Just for consideration. Sure. And if you were to want to do something like that, say, we're going to float it.
And we'll let you know, and then you drive by and say,
this day to this day,
yep.
It would give a visual of what it is.
Okay.
Go ahead.
The short of that, because again, we were going back to Cumberland Farms.
I'm sure something could be worked out. I'm just citing neighborhood character and social structure, and I'm open to other suggestions. I'm not saying I want this. I think that's something that could be worked on.
And we looked at the decisions from those up and down Route 5, and I mean specifically further to the south. The Irving, the red roof, I know the sign that shall not be spoken of, but the other ones that are down there are those taller signs. And, if, as I had said, if this was at the existing site, we wouldn't be asking for this size sign. Maybe we'd be asking for it, but I think it would be much harder to try to convince the town that this makes sense in that location. That is, think of it. You've got a four-way stop where the existing store is. You could put a monument sign if you could fit it on the site, set far enough back where it's not going to impact a lot. So, we'll go back and talk about it, because if that's a deal breaker, then I think we can probably modify it. But I think from our safety perspective, we like this height because of, as I think we've heard, as you're traveling, there may be vehicles in front of you. And you want to identify the site. And I guess besides that, you had also said you weren't going to vote positively on the site as a whole. Was there anything specifically?
I was addressing the situation with the traffic on
Elm. So the traffic? Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm. So what do you want to do? Do you want to withdraw without prejudice, file so we could get five? In her case, it would have been a 4-1 on the variance,
mm-hmm.
in the sites, the traffic, at minimum, it was a sure 2-no, and it was a kind of a questionable no. So it really was 3-no and 1-yes. So
could I ask one more question?
Sure,
about? Could you see yourselves unanimously approving a design where we did that write-in only, and so we closed the Elm Street curb cut?
Elm Street curb cut, yeah.
We further to the west.
East.
Well, west first, a write-in only, and then further to the east, full access. So there would be two curb cuts on Elm Street. We would eliminate, we would close that one and then pull one further to the west and then...
So you're saying if you're coming off Route 5,
yep.
It's right in only right from in, Route 5?
Correct.
Not from the traveling
on Elm Street, yeah. And then a full access further up.
I personally don't have a problem with coming off of Route 5 and zooming in or coming around the right turn lane only and zooming in, but I don't want to be coming from the center of town.
Right.
And going
correct.
In.
That's probably the
so if you're coming from center of town,
you would use
the backside, which I would call the east
drive.
Side,
sure.
Would
look
be a
excuse me.
Egress both in and out.
Yeah, that's why we are trying to openly speak about bringing that curb cut closer to Route 5, the in only, because you want to geometrically design it such that it restricts, physically restricts any other movements, but you still want the cars to discharge on site at that drive.
Yeah, yeah, that discharging onto that site only helps. I agree with that.
Okay.
Thoroughly.
And is that
it's just
something...
that darn left turn to come out.
Yes.
That's so the only...
Is that something...
And then coming in from the town.
Sure.
So, I mean, I can work through that.
Okay. So then if
yeah,
that
I don't
gets...
know about the other folks, I mean.
Right.
Yeah, I just want to make sure
okay.
that, you know, I think it's better.
Yeah, throw that this way.
Pockets. Holy cow. Watch out. What's next?
So, Councilor, would you like to...
Well, so I think...
Or would you like to continue and...
I think we'd like to...
And represent to five members.
So I think we would like to...
Right, that would be withdrawn.
Right.
The way you can add that without
right.
a new application.
Right. So I think what we can do, because what I'm hearing, and correct me if I'm wrong in that, is if we're able to design the site in a way that we have that right in only to the farther to the west on Elm Street, plus the full access further to the east, and then potentially reduce the sign to something less than 25, but maybe above 20 for the variance, depending upon how Cumberland Farms feels about that. If we're able to do that, it sounds like with the current constitution of the board, we would get the approval.
Hopefully. You have mine. I don't, we can,
okay. Yeah.
Again, we,
okay.
we can do another
okay.
straw vote if you.
Okay. No, I think I've got the sense of it. And so then I think we would like to continue. And if we go back and we cannot accomplish those things, then I think we will have to withdraw because we're not going to get an approval based on what I'm hearing and then resubmit to a five member and hopefully satisfy at least one or the other.
Okay.
So we, I think, formally request a continuation to, I would, I think your next available meeting.
What would your original application date?
November.
Well, he's going to request it in writing.
Sure.
He requests a continuation, and then we don't have to worry about the timeline. So what we're talking about, we got like 90 or 100 days to make a decision. If we didn't make a decision, then automatically they get whatever they want. As long as both parties agree that we want to keep continuing, we can continue for 3 years, and then we don't want that long, but just, no, but it's the legal thing to do. So I just want to, whatever date we pick, I can't make next Thursday or every two Thursdays after that.
Okay.
So I can make...
February 2nd?
What is... What's...
That's the first February. That's the first Thursday of February. Next Thursday is the 26th. The following is February 2nd.
I won't be here the 2nd.
Okay. And then... Do you meet any other days besides Thursday?
We can meet a different day. The date doesn't really, that's a good point, just like we offered up.
Okay.
We can meet another date. The only thing that sometimes happens is we need a conference room or something.
In the kitchen.
But yeah. We can meet in that room there. We can meet in the kitchen.
Okay.
Doesn't look like we have a big contingency here.
Planning board hearing is the 6th. How long do you think it'll take us to... Look at that design.
Probably a few weeks when we need to consider the stormwater.
Yeah, we might want to get
from DOT too.
I'm going to my calendar.
Like we might want to be able to support that.
Yeah. I mean, it'll give us time to figure it out. Okay, so...
The 16th, is that what you're thinking?
Just gonna, yeah, that's what I was...
Yep.
I'm looking at.
The 16th would work for me.
Works for me. Done?
Works for me.
Okay.
Okay. So
the second,
continuation to the 16th.
The second works.
But Ben's
the
9th not there, the
wouldn't.
Second.
The 16th would for me.
16th works, seems for everybody.
The second, right. The 16th is good for me.
February 16th.
And do it at the same time? Or a different time?
Yeah, the 16th is good, for me.
Are we going to stick with the 7 p.m.?
Does that work with you guys?
7 p.m.
7 p.m.? Okay, so... we'll take a vote to continue the hearing till it's February 16th. Now, the holiday is somewhere around the 22nd or something, that Monday is a holiday or whatever.
20th, so, yes, President's
Day. So we'll do that, and hopefully you can come back with some tweaks.
We'll see. I mean, to be honest, it may just not work, because we've got to talk to DOT to see if we can get, because they bought into this, so to see if we can get their buy-in. If not, then... I'll make sure that I communicate with Pat and Priscilla just to make sure that they can let you know if we're going to be requesting a withdrawal. Hopefully we could do that, you know, just by mail and not have to necessarily right. show up.
And why would you withdraw? Only because DOT won't?
Only because we can't do what the board that I'm hearing is asking us to do. So we're going to try to roll the dice with the five members.
Oh, then you'll go back with five.
Right.
Okay.
Exactly.
All right. All right, good. All right, so, yes. You'll send a note to Pat,
sure.
A memo, please. So I want to make a motion that we continue the Cumberland Farms hearing until February 16th, 7 p.m. at the town offices. And Council for Cumberland Farms will notify us in writing of their approval of a continuance. With that said, how do you vote, Linda? Ben?
Aye.
All right, myself, yes, and Mr. Decker, yes. So you guys definitely, again, the 16th would be our next meeting.
Okay.
And, and she should email and so forth.
Good.
Okay? And just for your, you guys should also, she generally had, I don't know if she's given you guys books with the laws and
nope.
regulations. She generally will give you a street listing of mm-hmm. all the people and so forth. And I'll be happy to answer any questions one-on-one if you have a question. We don't want to have a public meeting, but if you have some questions or something, I'll be happy to help and coach where we are. And thank you very much for joining and coming. Yeah, okay.
Oh,
we got one more. Oh, yeah, we got one more thing. Wow, you guys have been patient. I'm sorry. So we have a Brent Banas who requested time with the board for a preliminary discussion about lot variance on 247 Greenfield Road. And Bill's with it. So let us know what's going on.
Basically, what we wanted to do was just touch base with the board. Brent is thinking about applying for a special permit, and we're going to do plans for...
Is this Brent Young?
What's that?
Brent Young?
Brent
Banas.
Brent Banas.
Oh, where's 247?
The old lighthouse.
Lighthouse. Okay, great.
Property. He's proposing that it's... special permit is going to be required, but what we were wondering about, seeing it's going to be self-storage, our options are, because of the lot coverage of impervious material, we just wanted to touch base with the board, and as far as low impact development, what you would entertain. We can't pave all the way, like, this facility over in Hadley the lot is too small, we can't pave around the buildings. So we were exploring other ways of, at the storage facility, not in the front where the parking is, that's going to be paved, but where the storage buildings are and how they're arranged, we got some feasibility plans. We were thinking of going with some type of pervious roadways. We were thinking of either going with TRG.
So let me just, I don't want to go too far, but if my book isn't out of date, self-storage warehouse is not allowed in any of our zoning districts.
I think it was approved the last town meeting with a special permit.
Right. Okay. Well, I'm sorry, just let me one more second. When this was April 25th of this year. Okay. So do you know if our zoning laws were all accepted by the Attorney General?
According to the building inspector, they were.
That gives me a lot of faith too. Like what I said earlier, if you guys listen to me.
We'll check that out. But anyways, so we were thinking of ways, because he has to have access between the buildings for the people, going with multiple scenarios and then looking at the economics of doing it. If we're restricted to 60% coverage of the lot, seeing the lot so small, economically it's not even feasible to do the storage because you'd be limited to such a small portion of the lot. So what we were thinking about doing is just approaching the board and saying, would you accept TRG if we could prove that the runoff coefficient is 0.5 to 0.8, or the runoff coefficient for permeable pavers or permeable concrete or permeable pavement? And we'd have to do the economics to see which one would be economically feasible to do. I don't want to go by what people are telling me. They were saying, well, like at Douglas, they got TRG in the back and they've got a monster parking lot. So I just, instead of submitting multiple plans, we just wanted to touch base with you for 5 minutes and say, what is your feelings on it of the low impact development? What would you prefer?
So you want to exceed the lot, you want to exceed the lot coverage. With impervious surface?
No, we don't. Okay. We don't want a variance for exceeding it, but in your bylaws, it says that low-impact development is not considered impervious surfaces. So with the buildings and the paving in the front and the main office building, we don't exceed that. But if we do anything between the buildings, we want to make sure that it's considered low impact development and it's not considered impervious. In your bylaws,
yeah.
I gotta put my glasses on. I can't see. It's 60% coverage on the lot. Wrong ones.
So you don't want to exceed 60%?
No.
Okay.
Okay. We'll have less than 60% impervious surface. That's
you
buildings,
and
the
you don't
want
you don't
want
to use TRG, or you do want
to? No, the thing we have to do is it says buildings, parking areas, walkways, and other impervious surfaces. Low impact development techniques such as pervious pavers do not count as impervious surfaces. So we have to come up with some way for public safety to have the driveways or the access ways and the access road around be considered impervious. And the only things that we could think of is TRG or pervious pavers, concrete pavers, pervious concrete, or pervious bituminous concrete, asphalt.
Yeah.
And we just wanted to touch base with the board and say, would you consider that impervious any of those impervious surfaces, because it's really not specific. It only talks about pervious pavers.
Yeah. In the past, there has been instances that we've allowed TRG is impervious.
Impervious
surface. So is that what you're...
That's what we're...
We've allowed that before, and I'm surprised that they don't want the... They voted that pavers that are pervious pavers, that's the new thing. So
you would entertain TRG, you would entertain the pervious pavers. How about the pervious concrete?
Probably not pervious concrete.
Okay, how about pervious bituminous concrete?
Probably not asphalt either.
Not asphalt either, so.
But TRG, I'll call TRG probably, and yeah, but paving blocks that are pervious, probably. Yeah. But the biggest thing you got to do is you got to get through the special permitting process to, you know, is that the right thing for there?
But if you don't ask for any variances and it's approved, let's say it's approved by
the building commissioner. If it's approved by right, great.
It's approved by right, so.
But you need a special permit no matter what.
Yeah, we need a special permit.
From us.
Yeah. And we have to go to the planning board, and we have a meeting with the Conservation Commission already scheduled. But
do you have to make your site ADA accessible? Is that the problem with the, and the TRG is not?
No, I think blacktop, which is what we have at our current facility, is just cleaner, neater. It's more professional.
Yeah.
And in the winter for plowing, it's easier. I just think it's more professional.
But with the blacktop, if you're not going greater than the lot coverage.
We would be.
Oh, you would be?
Yeah.
But the existing is not. 60%.
Okay.
So
what he's saying is he wants to put 60, cover the property between the blacktop and the buildings would come to the 60%.
That would come to the 60%. So we've got no wiggle room for the access roads and in the alleyways.
Oh, okay.
And we were just feeling the board out and saying, what would you accept? There's no sense of proposing something you're not going to accept. Mm-hmm. And when I was talking to Brent, I said, to go for a variance, it's like you said earlier, a variance opens up a whole can of worms.
Yeah, it's very, very hard.
It's very, very hard, and all you need is one person.
So $75. Object.
And although it was passed at the last town meeting, I'm sure there's people that don't want self-storage facilities.
One here in particular.
That's a special permit.
Special permit.
That's an example.
The big difference.
Yeah.
Then a permitted
use. Okay.
But we don't want to ask for variances. But right. We just wanted to feel out what the board would accept. And now I know. Yep. That was our big question for the night.
Yep. All right, very good. So if you're all set, we're going to...
I'm just... You said you would consider pervious pavers, right? But...
Yeah, it says not. I don't know why, but if they're pervious. Not pervious, but pervious.
Right. Pervious. Pervious pavers.
Pavers, so right.
What's the... I don't understand, like, I guess the physics of the substance, but you wouldn't consider pervious concrete or pervious...
No, because... You're thinking of a different type of paver than I'm thinking of. Uh-huh. So the pavers that, if you're just putting pavers together, and people like to call that little seam in the middle being the pervious part, that's not a pervious paver. A pervious paver, actually, it might look like a checkerboard where it has lots and lots of holes in it. And then in between it, grass grows between it. So it's... Mm-hmm. If you've seen them.
No, I understand.
You can go, if you live in Hadley or somewhere, it sounds like, go to the university in Massachusetts, go where the dorms are, those big high-rises, mm-hmm. and they did a whole bunch of it. But what will happen is the paving block... Give me 1 second to finish this. This is why I think they were really thinking pavers and not pervious pavers.
That's what a pervious paver looks like. It has a, all those diamonds are wide open. So it's kind of like, I don't want to say it's like a cinder block turned
on
its side.
I've seen them too, where it's just a rectangular with a full cutout in the center of each one.
Right. So, and with that, you might even be able to have a case and say, if I just take this, the square inches of this, and I remove all these little diamonds, you may not even need to bring that up. You know what I'm saying? Because this may be only 50%. If you're using this, you might only have 50% of non-pervious versus pervious.
See, that's our question, what would you accept? And if you would accept TRG, we might go with the TRG. Just keep the amount of rock dust down and try to make it as pervious as possible. Mm-hmm. The soils out there probably have a C coefficient of about 0.5. You can easily achieve that with TRG 0.5, so it would be no different than the existing soils. Right.
So we'll leave it at that so that, you know, we don't violate.
Pervious pavers or TRG, asphalt in the front where the parking areas are.
Yeah.
In the public accesses.
Yep. Okay. All right. Robert, we're gonna make a motion to adjourn.
Thank you.
I'll make a motion that we adjourn.
Second, okay. And how do you vote?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Robert. And I also, yes. Generally, we don't go this long. All right, don't want to scare you guys.